السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وبعد. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We thank Him upon everything He's granted us. We really praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is important for us to ponder over the gifts of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for indeed, it is only upon pondering that we will realize His gifts. Today, we go through so many difficulties, so many issues, so much of disturbance that sometimes it clouds the way we look at the gifts of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because it requires a pondering upon the gifts of Allah to realize them. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his entire household, all his companions. May Allah bless them all and bless every single one of us. My beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, we all know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has set rules and regulations governing how we will fulfill our desires. So Allah made us, Allah created us. But at the same time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows that as humankind, we have certain needs, we will have certain needs. We will want to do certain things. For example, a person would love to earn in order to be able to eat good food, in order to be able to live in a good home, in order to be able to have decent clothing, in order to be able to have a decent conveyance or a motor vehicle, and so on. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has kept the halal way of doing it, which is an act of worship. And there is a haram way of doing it, which would be a sin, and it could be an act of worship when we abstain from it. So if someone has a haram way of doing something, and they stay away from that solely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's automatically an act of worship. If I see, for example, a wad of pound notes somewhere down here, what I do with that would depend whether I would actually earn a reward or a sin. If I were to look around and check that there's no one looking and then suddenly pinch it and put it in my pocket and that's it, I've failed the test. And that wealth will not come of any use to me, even though temporarily I'll get excited. The same rule applies to everything else, including marriage. And this afternoon we will be witnessing an officiation of a nikah. So I want to seize the opportunity to say a few words in this regard. Firstly, we need to know there is a haram way of doing things. If a person would like to abuse a woman, or if a person would like to have fun in terms of the opposite sex, the door is wide open for anyone and everyone. Those who abstain from it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have converted that into a good deed, an act of worship. And this is why the hadith of the seven people who will be shaded on the day of Qiyamah, one of them is رَجُلٌ دَعَتْهُ إِمْرَأَةٌ ذَاتُ مَنْصَبٍ وَجَمَالٍ فَقَالَ إِنِّي أَخَافُ اللَّهِ. A man who is called, or a person who is called by the opposite sex to indulge in that which is immoral, and there is no barrier between them and that immorality. The person is perhaps of a lot of wealth and a lot of, you know, goodness in terms of looks, but the sole thing that made them abstain from it is they say, I fear Allah. I'm worried about the day I return to Allah. I'm worried about the answer I will give Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If that is the case, then they've converted it to such a big act of worship that they actually deserve the shade on the day of Qiyamah that is mentioned in the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this goes to show that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows the base desire of man, and He knows what man would like to fulfill. And He's kept two doors. One is His door, the correct door, and the other is the wrong door, the door of the devil, the door of shaitan. So in order for us to be able to fulfill our base desires correctly and in the most beautiful way, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has simplified what we would term nikah, or the marriage. In Islam, officiation of marriage is one of the most simple things ever. Anyone who makes it difficult is fighting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Remember this. And I think culturally sometimes we have so many things that creep in that makes it difficult. Some people have a notion whereby the woman needs to pay a large amount of money in some cultures, and she needs to furnish the house, and sometimes she needs to bring about the accommodation in some cultures. In other cultures, it's the other way around, where the man is charged a large sum of money just in order to get married. Sometimes people make it so difficult where there is nothing wrong in getting your child married to such and such a person. But because we have tribal lines, because we have various other little barriers we've created outside of what the framework of Islam is, we tend to make it difficult. Those are the people who are fighting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When Allah has created ease for something, He does it for a purpose. And when we create difficulty for the same thing, we would be defeating the purpose or we would be fighting the cause. And this is why, if you take a look at the officiation of nikah, what is required? The father of the girl would give her in marriage, preferably, that is the sunnah way of doing things. If he is available, we should try our best to have him represent his own daughter. But at the same time, he needs to make sure that his daughter is happy. His daughter is okay with it. It is wrong for us to shove it down the women's throats. Today, people are looking at Islam, for example, and they have this notion that it is a religion that does not protect the rights of women. Whereas, in actual fact, it is the most protective of not only the rights of women, but the woman herself. Such that we cannot just do something, shove it down her throat. It's a matter of life. It's a matter of the entire life. It's a matter of the future. We have within our capacity guidance. We have within our capacity the ability to guide them to the correct path, to advise them, and so on. But at the end of the day, we cannot just come up with a proposition and say, my daughter, you are now married. Or, my daughter, we are getting you fixed next week. Who is it? Well, you'll find out next week. Allahu Akbar. And some people think that is Islam. My brothers and sisters, it is happening. And it happens across the globe with Muslims who sometimes are still bubbling in cultural norms that are far from humanity, let alone the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why it's important for us to know that we would seek the permission of the woman. You know, you need to seek permission in the sense that even if it is the father, even if it is the brothers or someone who's representing the sister or the female, they would have to say, is it okay for us to get you married to so and so? And she would have to agree with it. She would have to admit it. If she says no, we should not feel in our hearts that she has done something wrong. She is exercising her right. Subhanallah. She's exercising her right. And all this, as I said earlier, is in place from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in order for a system to be fulfilled, in order for a system to work correctly. If we were all forced in our own situations, whose marriages would work? It would be an encouragement of immorality, an encouragement of adultery, an encouragement of misconduct. But at the same time, what we need to realize, if things have been done with the consent of all parties, there is a greater likelihood of the heart being in the union. There is a greater likelihood of people remaining faithful, saying, this was my choice. How many times have people made the wrong decision? And we are not saying we are all angels. You know, we do sometimes make wrong decisions. Sometimes we don't gauge. Two lovely people, but they don't get along. How many times have people made the wrong decision, but they tell themselves, this was my decision, I'm going to make sure it works. Subhanallah. The reason is, it was their decision. But when it was shoved down their throats, 10 years down the line, they say, I never wanted to marry you. It was actually my pops who forced me. Astaghfirullah. We've heard this comment. We've heard people say this to children down the line. Why did you waste so much of time of people? Why did you tamper with people's lives? And this is why we tell the parents, do not be from amongst those who force people. It's not Islamic. It's nothing grand. It's nothing great. And if someone has exercised their right to refuse, remember, it is part of your duty to accept that they have exercised their right given to them by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is a very important aspect of the deen that a lot of people take for granted. So similarly, in the same way that I just said moments ago, it's important for us to create ease. It is also important for us to take into consideration the mindset of the people. It's important for us to understand that rejecting something solely on purposes that are not counted in an Islamic situation is unacceptable. For example, a proposal comes in the direction of your sister or your daughter, for example, and we have no reason to say no because the deen is okay, the khuluq is okay, you know, the level of deen is fine, the level of understanding is more or less similar, and there is no reason for us to deny, and we're just denying solely because, you know what? They live in the other suburb and we live in this suburb. They are from there and we are from here and so on. This type of behavior, yes, we may want to guide someone. You know, as parents, we are all, myself included, we are parents. Alhamdulillah, we ask Allah to make it easy for our offspring. But It's our duty to guide. Sometimes we have a dream in our minds, and this dream is that inshallah this will happen, that will happen. Inshallah my child will be married off and they will be this and they will be that. And before I know it, you know, by the age of 40, 45, I'll be a grandfather and so on. Wow, lovely plans. But remember, you plan, I plan. Allah plans, and Allah's plan is final. We have to adjust our dreams sometimes based on reality on the ground. So I had a big dream for my daughter, my son, and so on. Lovely, huge dreams. As time passes, the dream shall be adjusted based on what Allah has allowed to come to pass. This is something that's common logic. This is something that is called belief in fate. We tried, we did our best, but what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought forth is something that He decided. It's also a test for us to accept and acknowledge that this is how things happen. What is the best we can now do with this entire situation? So this is why it's important for us to guide, yes, but we do not have the capacity to shove things down the throats of people who are now adults, people who perhaps know what they want. Sometimes they might be making an error. And usually, especially nowadays, as we are progressing on the globe and we witness what's going on, we would advise people that if you have advised your child, and if your child seems not to digest your advice, perhaps you may allow them to make what you might term to be an error, what you might term to be a mistake temporarily. And who knows, it might work out. I'm not an angel, I'm not a prophet, I'm not Allah, astaghfirullah, I'm not a person who knows the unseen in any way. So I cannot say that this is definitely not going to work. Perhaps it was my advice. But because my advice was not palatable, it was not digested, maybe we may want to allow them to make, or it might be the better of the options to allow them to make what seems to us to be an error, yet they would either go through one of two things. One is, perhaps it would work by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why, give your children your blessings. Give them your dua. Pray for them. Ask Allah to guide them. Ask Allah to open their doors and understand it is Allah and Allah alone who is in control of the hearts. So perhaps it might work, alhamdulillah, the dua of the people. But say, for example, it didn't, and say something went wrong. They are always your child. They will respect you for having understood them. They will respect you for having stood up for them when they needed it most, and so on. This is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala really has taught us in terms of the issue of nikah. If we take a look at the way it happens, simple. The father is asked a question. Sometimes you can get away with one question, but sometimes two. One meaning, if the permission is already sought by the one who is officiating the nikah, for example, one question is to be asked that I'm offering you the daughter of so-and-so or this person with a mahr of so much in the presence of these witnesses. Have you accepted? And the young man will say, yes, I have. But generally, to make it absolutely clear, a good way of doing it is to ask the representative or guardian of the bride to ask him a question that, you being the guardian of so-and-so, have you given her in the nikah or in the marriage of so-and-so with a mahr of X amount? And you don't even need to make mention of the amount. You can say the agreed upon mahr, because the world does not need to know whether you've given £100 or £5 million, subhanallah. You know, keep it calm, inshallah. Let's not make it too expensive by the will of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like I said, to make things easy, don't make them difficult. But at the same time, when that question is asked and it is responded to in the affirmative, where he will say, yes, I have, then the question is now posed to the groom to say, so-and-so being the representative of the bride whose name is so-and-so has just given her in your marriage or in your nikah with a mahar of so much in the presence of so many witnesses that are here, perhaps this afternoon and so on, have you accepted her in your marriage or in your nikah as your wife? And he has to say, yes, I have. Subhanallah. The minute that happens, the nikah is officiated. How long did that take? It did not take more than a few seconds. This shows that Allah has made things so, so easy. Now, to add a sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which means a practice of our messenger, may peace be upon him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was that every time an officiation of nikah took place, number one is he would encourage people to attend. And this is why he says, have the nikah in the masjid. It's better to have it in the house of Allah. You know, one would say, let's have it in my house, let's have it your house, let's have it as a at a huge hall and so on. The nikah will be valid. It will be correct. You have it anywhere. You can have it on the street. But the more blessed place to have it is in the house of Allah, the house of your own maker. And it's such a blessed place. I wanted to get married. I went to the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and here it is, solemnized, mashallah. So what he used to do when the people used to gather, he used to spend a moment to give them advice. And this is something pertinent. It's something so important because he used to speak to all the categories of people. Let's take a look at some of the words he used to say. Ya ma'shar al-shabab man istata'a minkum al-ba'ata falyatazawwaj fa innahu ahsanu lil-fard wa aghaddu lil-basar. What a beautiful hadith. He says, O youth, O youngsters, whoever is able and capable, get married. Meaning don't delay in getting married. Don't waste your time. You're able, you're capable. Now get married. Because it's better for your sight. It's better for your, you know, the control of your desires and so on. It's much better for you. This is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaking to us through Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Beautiful advice. And he's telling us, if you are able and capable, get married. Look at the advice. Everyone sees a young man excited, you know, so excited on the day of his nikah. I recall one day I was officiating a nikah. And one of the brothers, you know, I asked him, so have you accepted her in your nikah? And he says, yeah, you know. And I'm like, hang on. You know, you've got to say, yes, I have. And he says, yes, you have. I said, not me, you. Subhanallah. So the excitement is what I'm talking. People are so excited. But what about you who are not married? Ask yourself, am I not happy for this man? Wouldn't I like to be in his place by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? You know, it's important for us to actively seek a spouse by the will of Allah. And you need to know what qualities to look for in a spouse. The spouse should be a person whom you are comfortable with to be the parent of your children. Either way, whether you're looking for a husband or a wife, depending on whom you are. You look for qualities that you would be able to comfortably say, I'm happy for this person to be the parent of my children. That is a one word answer, one sentence response. If you are happy that this person would be a brilliant father to your children or a brilliant mother to your children, by the will of Allah, you won't be going wrong. Because you would be looking at the taqwa levels, the levels of closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But you wouldn't just be looking for the most scantily dressed person on the street and say, wow, let me just choose this person, you know, to be with. They might make a good trophy in the arm. You know what that means? You probably walk down the street with everyone looking around. One wonders how long it would last. One wonders what would happen to the kids. One wonders what would happen to your pocket, my beloved sister or brother, depending, you know, either way. Nowadays, you cannot just say brother because sometimes the sisters are the ones who have all the cash, mashallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all. May He make it easy for us. So, inshallah, we should learn a lesson. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to address people completely. One of the verses he used to read, and I will just speak of one of them, inshallah, a powerful verse. It is known as khutbatul hajah. You know the khutbah that was read before the nikah and sometimes on special occasions. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu ittaqullaha wa qulu qawlan sadida yuslih lakum a'malakum wa yaghfir lakum dhunubakum wa man yuti'illaha wa rasulahu faqad faza fawzan 'azima. O you who believe, be conscious of your maker and only utter that which is upright. Qulu qawlan sadida. Utter that which is upright. Sadid means straight. Why would that advice be for all of us, especially on the occasion of getting together as spouse? The reason is, a lot of the times, the difficulties caused in marriage are connected to the tongue. Either people speak too much or they don't speak at all, mashallah. You know, I recall a case that I was involved in some years back. And a guy was complaining, my wife talks a lot. And when we had spoken to her, she said, I'm never going to speak again. You know how it is with the salt and so on. So what happened is, he greets, no response. He says anything, no response. And then he came back to complain. And then she says, look, let him make his mind up. Do I talk too much? What's the story, you know? If he wants, I'll remain silent. But the lesson we learn is a balance. We need to strike a balance. Know what to say, when to say it, and how to say it. These are three very important questions. Ask yourself, what do I want to say? How can I say it? And is it the right time to say it? If any one of those answers are negative, then abstain, stay away from it. Perhaps then you might want to remain silent. But if, for example, it's the time to say something and you don't say it, and you know that you have to say it, then too, there's going to be a problem. There's going to be something disastrous. So if you take a careful look, those two things mentioned in that verse, ittaqullaha, which means be conscious of Allah, and qulu qawlan sadidan, say that which is upright. So it upright meaning far from vulgarity, far from abuse, far from provocation, far from falsehood, far from deception and so on, you know, no sin in your speech in terms of backbiting, slander and everything else. If you can make sure that these two things are in you as a person, by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you would minimize the problems that may arise in your own marriage. Not only in your marriage, but in anything, subhanallah. If you have taqwa Allah, you are conscious of Allah. Your aim is to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And at the same time, you are conscious of what you say, how you say it, when you say it, at all times. You will lead a happy life, a much better life than a lot of the others. And this is why it's important for us to take this advice of the Quran seriously. In fact, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the same verse tells us that if you are to be a person who's conscious of Allah and worried about the tongue, then by the will of Allah, your deeds will be made good for you. They will be made good for you. You see, if I've done a lot of good deeds, I read my salah and so on, but I backbite and I slander and I swear and I say bad things with my tongue, the reward of my salah is going to go to someone else. The reward of the good deeds I've done will go away. So it won't be good enough for me. Those deeds have belonged to someone else because on one hand I did good and on the other hand I did bad. So the good and bad cancelled each other. This is why we have a scale. When you do good, make sure that you don't cancel it with the bad. Remember this. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us when you are conscious of Allah and conscious of what you utter, we will make your deeds good enough. We will make them good, pure, and we will forgive you. Forgive you meaning expiate the minor sins that you have committed by virtue of the goodness you've done. I'm sure you've heard of the hadith, أَتْبِعِ السَّيِّئَةَ الْحَسَنَةَ تَمْحُهَا. If you follow your bad deeds with good deeds so that they may be wiped out. Wiped out meaning minor sins are wiped out if you continue to do good deeds thereafter. And this is something we are taught. And this is why Allah says, وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ فَقَدْ فَازَ فَوْزًا عَظِيمًا. Whoever follows what is revealed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whoever follows the goodness that is brought, definitely they are the ones who will be successful. They are the successful, a great success. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all.
اقرأ كتاب الله ترق جنانه وتن العظيم الأجر والغفران رتله روي القلب من نفحاته كالماء يروي لهفة العطشان.